Hey guys, welcome to Uncharted Health. Let's check out this video call. It's a new Napoleon video, okay? I've been reacting to a lot of Napoleon videos. The reason why I didn't upload any videos like yesterday or day before yesterday is because the previous Napoleon video that I reacted to, I did two Napoleon video reactions in one video. And it's like, what the fuck? You know, it was so crazy and it was so intense and it was so, I gotta admit, I'm kind of tired of seeing so many people die in the most horrible ways possible. And I was like, oh man, I'm like, should I even watch another one? That's how bad I'm feeling right now. The Napoleon's retreat from Moscow, 1812, that thing was so fucking bad. I was like, I mean, so horrible. The people that are dying in there were so horribly dying that it was like, man, the slowest death with the most painful way. And getting hunted in the middle of all this shit too by the enemies. And it's like, and also got like a little bit of backlash for saying the Kutuzov guy was a coward or anything. He was not, okay? I was just pissed off at how he was chasing Napoleon, like cornering Napoleon, making him run to save his own life. And it was like, holy shit, I never thought Napoleon was gonna get cornered and run around so in a hurry to save his life and shit. So I was like so angry and I said Kutuzov is a coward or something like that, but I didn't really mean it. So stop disliking the video and hating on me for saying so. I'm not trying to offend you guys or anything, so stop it, okay? But whatever, okay? Your wish, whatever you want to do, you do. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if I get dislikes or likes. It don't, never matter. Never. I'm going to forget this shit in a span of 1 week. Like the previous, all that dislikes and everything. This story, this whole thing, I'm going to remember. The Napoleon, whatever he went through, I'm going to remember. But, you know, all the backlash is like, come on, I'm not a mean guy, okay? Whatever, all right, whatever, okay? So Napoleon, 1813, Road to Leipzig. That's what we're going to react. The Road to Leipzig, is it going to be 10 times worse? I hope not. Like, the previous one is the worst shit I've ever seen about war. Like, honestly, I've never seen anything so horrible like that. So whatever, man, let's just get into this video. I'm talking too much. Let's get into a Napoleon 1813, The Road to Leipzig. And after I finish this reaction, please don't be offended, okay? Please don't. And try to understand, I'm not mean, I'm not hating on a character, I'm not a blind French fan or anything. I'm not a Napoleon super fan. I like Napoleon, but I'm not blinded by his greatness or anything. Come on, dude. Whatever, okay? Let's just get into this. Napoleon, 1813, The Road to Leipzig. I hope it's not fucking maniac-like. I hope it's not a video where people are dying left and right slowly and oh my god. Whatever, let's just get into it. 3, 2, 1, let's go, man. Wow. This is... Alright, calm down. Alright. 1080p. Let's do it. What the fuck? Let's go. 3, 2, 1, let's go. Oh shit, a coat. By who? Okay. What a career Napoleon has ruined. Having gained so much glory, he could bestow peace on Europe, but he has not done so. The spell is broken. Emperor Alexander of Russia, Vilna, December 1812. So This man from Russia, emperor from Russia was actually disappointed by Napoleon. Wow, what a career Napoleon has ruined. Gained so much glory. He could have bestowed peace on Europe, but he has not done so. And his spell is broken. That's what he's saying. Yeah, after all that shit in the previous video, this is confirmed. Anybody would be thinking like this. That's how bad it went. So fuck this. All right, let's get into it. Wow, the spell is broken indeed.
Huh. 1812 had been a disastrous year for Napoleon.
Huh.
His invasion of Russia had led to the almost total destruction of an army of 500,000 men.
Wow, I know, right?
Now, Poland and Germany were wide open to Russian attack.
Okay.
Some advised Emperor Alexander that this was the time to make a favourable peace with Napoleon.
Yeah!
Russia's own armies had been mauled, and Western Russia devastated.
Wow!
But Alexander was determined to see Napoleon defeated for good, to free Europe from his clutches, and avenge Moscow's destruction by taking Paris.
Okay.
Napoleon's allies were deserting him.
Yeah.
Russian troops.
After all that, I think even I would start have some doubts. Is Napoleon really the great, or is he just is he like careless? I don't know, because so many people died. He went in with 500,000 people and came back with almost nothing. It's ridiculous.
Had already agreed a truce with the Russians. Schwarzenberg's corps marched back to Austria, which assumed a policy of watchful neutrality. Napoleon had left Marshal Murat in charge of the remnants of the army, but he left for the Kingdom of Naples, hoping to cut a deal with the Allies that would let him keep his throne.
Wow, okay. Murat.
He was replaced by Napoleon's stepson, Eugene.
Eugene.
Who'd proved himself a brave and able soldier in Russia, but was unused to independent command, and now faced odds of 4-1.
Dang. Wow!
As Russian forces advanced through Poland, he continued to retreat west.
Oh shit!
Leaving garrisons to hold strategic fortresses, most of which were soon besieged.
Oh god! I can't take this amount of failures. This is too much. This is crazy, bro.
On the 7th of February, Russian troops entered Warsaw unopposed. Napoleon's Polish client state, the Duchy of Warsaw, effectively ceased to exist. 3 weeks later, Russian troops entered Berlin, while Sweden joined the Allies.
Oh shit. Okay.
Sweden was ruled by Napoleon's former marshal Bernadotte, now officially known as Crown Prince Karl Johan.
Karl Johan.
Many would accuse him of betraying Napoleon, but he'd always been clear that once he became Sweden's Crown Prince, he'd pursue Swedish interests, which is what he now claimed to do.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you can call it betrayal. Once you go into another place and you're following their orders, I don't know about, you know, I don't know if you can call it betrayal, because he's following their orders and he's doing what he needs to do over there. And, you know, it's not like you're his, it's not like you're his big, like his mentor or anything. Like even then it would be like he would still be doing whatever they wanted him to do. Like seriously, it's not a betrayal. It might sound betrayalist, like a backstabbing thing, but it's not really, you know.
Exchange for Norway to be taken from France's ally Denmark, and £1 million from Britain. Bernadotte agreed to join what was now the 6th coalition against France since the revolution.
Oh.
With an army of 30,000 troops.
30,000 troops!
10 days later, King Frederick William of Prussia declared war on France.
Oh.
It followed weeks of indecision. The king was widely seen as a weak character and terrified of Napoleon. But with guarantees of Russian military support, the return of lost territory, and enormous financial and material aid from Britain.
Oh man, these fucking Britain people, they're just funding the war at this point. What is going on with them? Seriously?
He agreed to field an army of 80,000 men.
Oh god.
On the 17th of March, he issued a proclamation to the people of Prussia and Germany. An mein Volk, to my people, summoning them to fight for Prussia and Germany's honor, in what would soon be known as the German War of Liberation.
Liberation!
The Prussian army had been greatly reformed since its humiliating defeat to Napoleon in 1806. A military commission headed by General von Scharnhorst had sacked nearly 200 old generals and abolished flogging,
Oh.
Expanded recruitment, and introduced exams for officers.
Officers.
And overhauled training, tactics,
and drill. Wow. That's insane.
When Napoleon met the new Prussian army in battle 2 months later, he remarked, "These animals have learned something."
Whoa!
Small consolation. They'd learned most of it.
After all that, you would fucking hate Russians so hard. You would be like, "These fucking animals," and then you would you would talk about them in the most insulting ways possible. Because you hate them so hard, you know? After all that shit that happened in the previous video, you know, you would be like, "Fuck these Russian people." That's how you'd be like. But they were doing what they wanted, but Napoleon got the shit end of the stick, I guess, you know?
Fit from him. This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream, home of more than 2,500 online documentaries.
Right.
Exploring science, technology, the natural world, and of course, history.
Damn.
This month,
I love documentaries and I would love to watch these things, but I can't buy this subscription thing, whatever they are offering. I'm not American, okay?
We've been watching a French documentary about that other great warrior son of France, William the Conqueror.
Huh.
William is famed for his bloody victory over the English at Hastings in 1066. But here, we also learn about William's early life in Normandy, his loving marriage, and the long struggle to acquire his English kingdom. The reconstructions are high quality, the experts are insightful, and William the Conqueror gets a thumbs up from us. There are many other high-end documentaries like this waiting to inform and entertain you at CuriosityStream, which is available worldwide. An online subscription starts from just $2.99 a month.
Huh.
Remember to use the promo code
EpicHistoryTV
at sign up to get your first 30 days free. Thanks to CuriosityStream for sponsoring this video.
Alright, go buy that shit if you're interested in documentaries about historical stuff. I would love to watch these things, but god damn it, I don't have the subscription. And I'm not American, so, you know. Alright, a coat! Amazing coat! Let's go! What is this? Who is it from? Oh, Napoleon. Okay. "Only a short time ago, I was the conqueror of the world, commanding the largest and finest army of modern times. That's all gone now." Yeah. After all that happened, I guess I have to blame you. Like, I did blame you in the end of that video because I don't know, with all that shit happening and your carelessness and your lack of planning and all the weather changes and everything that was happening, it all came down to you and your problems and your lacking of some planning, you know, and I had to blame Napoleon, you know, for that, because so many people were dying left and right and as if they weren't being tortured without food and walking around. They were walking naked because they couldn't even carry their clothes on their bodies anymore. So it was like fucking horrible. Literally felt like I was watching something from hell. And, you know, and then they were being hunted by these Cossacks or whatever the fuck they are. And it was so horrible to watch. And I had to blame Napoleon for that because he is the one that made this happen, you know? And I wish I could take it back, but what can I do? You know, it just sucks. Napoleon to Count Mall, Tuileries Palace, February 1813. We're in 1813 now, guys. Let's get into it. Dang.
As his enemies massed in Germany, Napoleon was in Paris, working tirelessly to build a new army with which to face them.
Oh, yeah,
137,000 new conscripts joined the army, and laws passed to call up 100,000 more.
Oh.
While 40,000 veterans from the army in Spain, 16,000...
I don't know about giving that many men. They probably are afraid what's going to happen this time because they're following Napoleon again. And it's like, what? You know? How many people? It's like almost like they're giving back all the 500,000 troops that he used to like invade Russia and everything. You know? It's just... How many people, man?
1,000 Marines,
Let's just go lightly a little bit. Let's just go with a decent 150,000 troops or 200,000 troops at best, and keep that at a minimum, or lower it down a little bit too, and go with a decent size amount of troops and actually deliver a victory. Now, I don't know about going back to like 300,000, 400,000, back to 500,000 or some shit, and making things terrible again. I don't know about that.
80,000 men of the National Guard, a home defense force, were transferred to Germany.
Oh, okay.
The new conscripts were nicknamed Marie Louises, after Napoleon's young wife, who passed the new conscription laws in his absence.
Oh!
They were young and raw. Okay. Two-thirds were teenagers.
Oh, of course.
And there was a severe lack of experienced officers and NCOs.
Yeah, I probably shot one bird in their life, and I'm like, oh, now I'm a fucking soldier. Really? Well, I'm just downplaying the whole thing, but still, like, you know, they're very young. They don't know much. They don't even have that much life experience or anything. They're just amateurs. They've just been pushed into this. Completely fucking brainwashed, thinking that they have to be a troop no matter what. That's the way of life here, son, or something. And then they go in there and you know, I don't know. I guess they'll fight, but it's not going to be effective. It's like throwing a bunch of pillows at the enemy, you know? That's, I don't know. It's like that.
Short the countless irreplaceable veterans now lying beneath Russian soil.
Huh.
There was also a critical shortage of cavalry.
Oh,
shit! A crisis
shit.
Mocked by British satirists.
Oh, cavalry.
It would take Napoleon longer to replace the many thousands of horses
and trained horsemen
who'd perished in Russia.
Yeah, that's why I blame Napoleon. So many fucking horses died, and they were eating horse meat because they were dying too, and it's like, what the fuck? Dead horse meat and shit. I'm glad they didn't resort to cannibalism, although I think they might have eaten, you know, engaged in cannibalism a little bit, considering how many people were dying, you know? Holy shit. Who knows? Maybe somebody's eating somebody's meat. Who knows, man?
When Napoleon left Paris for Germany in mid-April, the French situation was precarious. Eugène had been forced back behind the river Elbe to the fortified city of Magdeburg.
Okay.
Dresden, the capital of Saxony, had fallen to the Prussians. The Duchy of Mecklenburg-Schwerin became the first German state to defect from Napoleon's Confederation of the Rhine.
Wow.
Russian Cossacks raided as far as Hamburg,
inspiring
local revolts against French occupying forces.
Oh my god! These Cossacks are so... make me so angry. Every time they show up, it's like they're like fairy princesses on horses, but they murder and fucking, you know, use their spears to fucking impaling people, and in just stupid. I hate them so much. Whatever, you know. Dang.
Meanwhile, Austria stood on the sidelines, so far declining to back either side. Napoleon's miraculous feat of organization meant he now had more than 200,000 troops in Germany.
Oh, shit!
And the Emperor's personal magnetism was undimmed.
Oh, man.
The morale of his army was high.
Yeah.
The Russian...
it still didn't... His reputation was not completely ruined, and people still believed in him. And he got equal... just as much amount of support he got before he invaded Russia. And things were even dangerous now, so might as well support Napoleon. He's the only one that can do it, or that has any experience in doing it, you know? So I don't blame them. It's like, seriously.
Russians, on the other hand, lost their iconic commander, Field Marshal Kutuzov, to pneumonia on the 28th of April.
Oh my god, really? 28th April he passed away? Man, he really pissed me off in the previous video. I was like, I was really angry at him. He's a coward. That's what I said. But, you know, he was doing what he needed to do. And, you know, these Russians were so patriotic that they would fucking hunt down Napoleon. They would make him... This guy was fucking making Napoleon run to save his life. That's how fucking crazy this guy was. But rest in peace, okay? Pneumonia. Wish there was pneumonia medication or whatever back in the day, but sucks, okay? Sucks.
His role was taken over by General Wittgenstein. Russian troops were exhausted and far from home. Their army weakened by the need to contain French garrisons across Poland and Germany.
And Germany, okay.
Prussia and Sweden had yet to fully mobilize their strength, and Allied forces barely mustered 100,000 men.
The enemies always seem to lack in numbers compared to Napoleon. He's like always so rich with so many troops in support, and the morale is always high. And Napoleon is like a fucking beast, man, compared to all the enemies. And the enemies are making Napoleon kind of retreat every now and then. It's like, what? Not like retreat, but more like trap him, make him run to save his life, and all that. It's just kind of crazy if you think about it. These Russians are fucking, they're not a joke. They're crazy, you know?
We're now heavily outnumbered by Napoleon, and the French emperor decided to strike quickly.
Huh.
He ordered Marshal Davout to Hamburg with 35,000 men to secure his northern flank.
Northern flank, okay.
He would march against the Russian and Prussian forces converging on Leipzig to force a decisive battle.
Oh.
Victory would make Austria think twice about joining the Allies. Allow him to rescue the 90,000 men trapped in garrisons across Germany and Poland, and re-establish his dominance over Europe.
Dang! Wow! Okay, if the art of war was only the art of not taking risks, glory would belong to mediocrities. We need a full triumph. See how passionate and how inspiring Napoleon is. That's what I love about Napoleon. Napoleon to his marshals, June 1813. He didn't accept defeat. He didn't like stay down and cry in the corner. It's not like that. He came back. He gathered as many troops he could with highest morale possible, and he attacked, and he went back. It's insane, you know? He's so inspirational. I love that. That's crazy. Full triumph.
As Napoleon advanced on Leipzig, the Allies faced a predicament.
Huh.
To risk battle against Napoleon's larger army, or give up Germany without a fight.
Oh.
Potentially devastating blow to Allied morale and any chance of winning Austria over to their cause.
Shit!
Allied headquarters made the bold decision to attack. They knew most of Napoleon's army was made up of raw conscripts, but their own troops were better trained and had a great superiority in cavalry and artillery.
Oh, they knew about that? That's terrible. Now they're gonna be so... like, they're going to be so dominating in terms of skills and everything, you know? So I don't know if they can pull it off. I don't know, man. That's terrible, honestly. And who told them that it was just raw conscripts and, you know, not many experienced soldiers? How did they know that? Did they send a spy amongst them and told them to come back and give them information or something? I don't know.
The Allies agreed that as Napoleon crossed the Saale River, they would hit his right flank before he could concentrate the full mass of his forces. The two armies were on a collision course. But Napoleon's shortage of cavalry meant he lacked information about Allied movements. On the 1st of May, Marshal Bessières, commanding the cavalry in Murat's absence, was carrying out reconnaissance himself. He was hit by a cannonball. And killed instantly.
Oh my god!
Bessières was the second of Napoleon's marshals to be killed in action.
Oh god!
And like Lannes,
it's really a terrible thing to lose a commander or a general or something like that. It's very terrible. Like, he knows how to command everything, bro, and he died. Like, instantly with a cannonball. What are the chances of getting hit by a cannonball? randomly in a war. Like, holy shit. Like, I can't believe some of these. And these cannonballs are doing major damage to some of the important figures throughout this whole videos that I've been reacting to in this playlist. That's like so crazy. That must be like 1 in a million chance to get hit by a cannonball, because you don't really know where the cannonball is going. It most likely goes into a crowded place of enemies, right? But then a commander gets hit by it and dies in a second. And it's like, what the fuck, you know? Or did they like snipe him with a cannonball? I don't think so. That's fucking crazy. It's ridiculous.
Old comrade and trusted friend.
Huh. That's sad.
The Allies were able to surprise Napoleon, falling on Marshal Ney's 3rd Corps near Lützen.
Huh.
Ney's troops had to cling on in the face of a Russian and Prussian onslaught, while Napoleon rapidly redirected his other corps to fall on the enemy's flanks.
Enemy's flanks. Good!
At one stage, Napoleon had to personally help rally routing troops as they broke in the face of determined Prussian assaults.
Oh, man.
But on the whole, his young conscripts fought with courage.
Huh.
And despite hours of savage fighting, Wittgenstein could not exploit his early advantage.
Oh, man!
As French reinforcements arrived, the battle turned against him.
Oh, shit!
Towards dusk, the Allies were forced to break off the engagement.
Oh, man. Look at the... It's so big, this whole war. It's like, do you even understand what's happening over there? You really don't know what's happening over there unless they're really doing in a formation. Then you can see the formation doing something, right? But you don't really know because it's like so many people so far away and we don't know what's happening. That's how fucked up it is. I guess unless you get trained into observing how to see what's going on, what's wrong with what formation and whatnot. I hope they train you on that, you know, as a commander, you know, commander or general or something. If you're like a general, you probably know what's happening over there. And how would you send the message for the people that are out there if you're here? I don't know. That's like, I don't understand most of the war of those days, you know. It's complicated as hell. Like, look at this shit. That's insane.
Did around 22,000 casualties.
Oh.
Losing just half as many men.
Lützen casualty estimates. French casualties, 22,000 again. That's a lot of people dying. Prussian casualties. Look
General
at that.
Von Scharn.
8,500. That's very low compared to French. Man, these people are like tough. Oh, fuck.
Von Horst, mortally wounded, was among them.
Oh.
Crucially, wow. Napoleon's lack of cavalry meant he was unable to pursue the enemy, who retreated in good order.
Huh.
Expecting the Prussians to fall back on Berlin, Napoleon sent Marshal Ney in pursuit, while he continued east.
Hmm.
But the Allied army stayed together, withdrawing to a defensive position at Bautzen, deliberately close to the Austrian border, hoping to entice Schwarzenberg to intervene
daring
Napoleon to violate Austrian neutrality.
Oh!
Neither happened.
Oh, good!
Instead, Napoleon ordered Ney to swing south to fall on the Allies' northern flank.
Flank them!
While
good!
While he launched a frontal assault to pin them in place.
Oh, pin them in place then. Good job! Finally, some planning that is actually probably working. That's good.
The battle lasted 2 days as infantry struggled forward against the Prussian and Russian lines.
Wow.
But a misunderstanding over Ney's orders caused a delay that allowed the Allies to narrowly escape Napoleon's trap.
Oh shit! Oh, come on.
Once more, the Allies fought with great determination and inflicted many more losses than they suffered.
Oh, okay. Bautzen casualty estimates. How 2 days of war. Okay, French casualties again, 25. Why are they keep losing 20 something thousand people every time? And, you know, Allied casualties, 10,000. Man, like 2 days of war, and because it's made of raw conscripts, that's why. They're inexperienced and so many people are dying. young kids are dying. Damn! That's fucked up, man.
There were more casualties during the pursuit, including the next day, General Duroc, Grand Marshal of the Palace, responsible for Napoleon's personal arrangements, and his closest surviving friend. Riding with Napoleon's staff, a freak cannon shot ricocheted off a tree
and disemboweled
him.
What?!
His slow, painful death.
Wait. Some random shot can ricochet off of something and still hit you and kill you? I've only seen that in the movies. I can't believe that happens in real life. That's insane. I mean, it can happen if you think about it, but that's like, you gotta be super, like, super lucky to get that kind of shot, you know? But man, this dude must have suffered so hard. That is like fucking miraculous kill or something. Dang.
Deeply upset Napoleon.
Oh shit. Painful and slow death. And it upset Napoleon, man. Wow.
The emperor continued his pursuit to Breslau, once again hindered by his lack of experienced cavalry, while Oudinot was sent north to take Berlin, but was held at Luckau by von Bülow's Prussian corps.
Wow. This is insane!
On the 2nd of June, with both sides strained to breaking point, neutral Austria proposed a ceasefire, which, to the surprise of many, Napoleon accepted.
Damn! Napoleon accepted! Oh, shit. My eagles are again victorious, but my star is setting. Napoleon to General Colin Court, Saxony, 2nd May 1813. My God! Oh God, I don't know what to say! This is insane!
The armistice of Plaswitz would last more than 2 months, a period of intense diplomacy and military mobilization by both sides.
Wow.
Napoleon wanted time to rebuild his cavalry, a shortage of which had allowed the Allies to escape twice.
Okay.
But he also wanted to keep Austria on side, which he feared might join the Allies with
The Austrians could join and fuck up the whole thing, you know?
200,000 troops. Even though Emperor Francis I was now his father-in-law.
Yeah! Since that doesn't make any sense. I know he married his daughter, and yet still, it's like, you're still worried that they might join in the war. It's like, what is this? Like, have some respect, goddammit!
Napoleon's marriage to his daughter, Marie-Louise, in 1810.
Wow.
Austrian Foreign Minister Clemens von Metternich, who'd become one of 19th century Europe's most influential statesmen, now took center stage. Metternich wanted peace, and to see Austria restored as a great European power, which meant Napoleon contained, but not crushed, which would hand too much power to Russia.
Yeah! Yeah, he wanted peace, so do anything for peace, guys. Don't engage in war. We don't need wars, okay? We don't want bloodshed. Please, somebody with some kind of common sense needs to be in this. Like, seriously, we need peace. Come on.
June, he traveled to Dresden to ask Napoleon to make concessions, while promising the Allies that if he did not, Austria would join them.
Oh, shit! I don't know about that.
Napoleon dismissed Metternich's terms out of hand. He would not return the Illyrian provinces to Austria, agree to the repartition of Poland, or the breakup of the Confederation of the Rhine.
Oh man.
All were out of the question.
Wow. But I mean, that's a lot of change, and he doesn't want all of that shit happening, you know. I guess maybe he has some different kind of plan, and he is known for being a brilliant strategist in a war, so I don't know what Napoleon's plan is. It's insane.
Napoleon famously threw his hat to the ground in fury.
Yeah.
Peace and war lie in your Majesty's hands, Metternich is said to have warned him. Today you can still make peace. Tomorrow it may be too late.
Think about it, Napoleon, think! Peace could make things better. You don't always have to win and fight, you know. Sometimes winning is like staying calm, You know, that's much better, you know. I don't want to see people slowly trying to walk naked and die and then get hunted by cocksacks and all of that shit, you know, so.
But Napoleon preferred war to what he called a humiliating peace.
Yeah, that would be humiliating, I understand, but still, how long, how many people, like, you got kids in your, you know, army, like, come on, dude, you can't let them, you can't make them fight all the time, I don't know about that, you know? I understand Napoleon, but I don't know what to say. Okay. Expect a defeat whenever the emperor attacks in person. Attack and defeat his lieutenants whenever you can. Oh, shit. General Moreau to Emperor Alexander. Silesia, July 1813. Dang. A lot of people have been talking. And a lot of, you know, warnings and a lot of things. It's crazy. Dang. Defeat his lieutenants whenever you can.
On the 12th of August, 1813... Austria joined the Sixth Coalition and declared war on France.
War on France, huh?
The Allies now had a numerical advantage of 3-2. And a new strategy, the Trachenberg Plan.
The Trachenberg Plan.
Recognizing Napoleon's genius, the Allies would avoid battle with the Emperor and instead target his marshals, threaten his flanks, and wear down French forces until it was time to close in for the kill.
Oh man!
Over the next few months,
that's what the, you know, the enemy. I think when I watched the oversimplified videos, even in there, in the ending of those, that video, they kind of explained to us that the enemy didn't focus on Napoleon anymore. They were focusing around his flanks and the other, you know, types of armies and his surroundings, and completely trap him and defeat him or something like that. That's what they were planning on. So I don't know what to say. You know, I guess the best way to tackle Napoleon is to, you know, defeat his surroundings and then capture him or something like that. You know. Fuck.
The coalition would also receive massive material support from Britain.
These British guys are fucked up, okay? Why are they funding this war? Why are they, like, I mean, I get it. They don't like this, you know, the blockade of the, what do you call it? The Navy blockade. They don't like that, but still, it's like, they're just, it's like a third party interfering, and I don't like that, you know? Whatever.
Including... Right. £8 million in silver and gold coin, 200 cannon with transport, 120,000 firearms, 18 million rounds of ammunition,
18 million,
30,000 barrels of gunpowder,
what?
30,000 swords and sabers,
what the fuck?
150,000 uniforms,
oh my god,
175,000 pairs of boots, 1.5 million pounds of beef, biscuit,
beef,
and flour.
Holy shit!
28,000 gallons of rum and brandy.
Rum and brandy?
The total value of British aid to the coalition in 1830.
Oh my god, these people are like so annoying. What? This much, the 18 million rounds of ammunition. Fucking 150,000 uniforms. Pair of boots, 175,000 pair of boots. What the fuck is this? Is insane. Stop the bloodshed, goddammit.
13 was £11.3 million.
Wow.
Today, worth around $500 million.
This is insane,
Napoleon,
bro.
Napoleon, meanwhile, had turned Dresden into a major supply depot and strengthened his cavalry arm, though it remained a pale shadow of its glorious past.
Wow.
Murat returned to lead it.
Oh, he returned back?
To the Allies having been rebuffed.
Okay.
But when news arrived of King Joseph's disastrous defeat to Wellington's Anglo-Spanish-Portuguese army at the Battle of Vitoria, Napoleon had to send Marshal Soult, one of his best commanders, to salvage the situation.
Huh. Oh, the shit in Spain is hitting the fan. That's exactly what's happening. And I hope they fucking... I hope the Suchet guy, everybody runs away from it. Spain is a lost cause at this point. Forget it. You know, we have much more dangerous things to handle, like Russia, you know? So, forget Spain. They have 6,000 people, troops of these... unique troops that fucking torture and murder and shit like that. So just run away from them. It's not a good time. Let the Spain be in peace, whatever they like. Let the people of Spain enjoy their, you know, their patriotism. Forget them, okay?
On the 15th of August, Napoleon left Dresden and advanced against what he considered the most urgent threat.
Oh.
The joint Prussian-Russian army of Silesia.
Huh.
Commanded by General Gebhard von Blücher.
Oh my
soon
god.
Soon to win the nickname Marshal Vorwärts. Marshal Forwards for his...
He looks so intimidating, man. Look at that mustache. So evil. Oh my god, look at it.
Aggressive leadership.
Oh man. I think he can kill you just by looking in you, looking at you in your eyes. He can kill you he can one-shot you with that. Or something. He's that fucking, you know, straightforward. He looks very intimidating. He looks scary.
But Blücher followed the new plan and retreated when he learned of Napoleon's advance.
Really? Come on!
Napoleon then received news from Marshal Saint-Cyr, holding Dresden with 20,000 men, that Schwarzenberg's gigantic army of Bohemia was approaching.
Huh.
And the city and its supplies were in danger.
We're in danger. Oh, fuck.
Napoleon left Marshal MacDonald to keep an eye on Blücher and raced back to Dresden, sending Van Damme's First Corps to threaten Schwarzenberg's communications.
Oh.
By the time the Allied assault began, enough reinforcements had arrived to fight off the attack.
Oh, shit! Battle of Dresden! Oh!
The next day, despite being heavily outnumbered, Napoleon ordered a counterattack. Struggling through mud and heavy rain, Marshal Murat's advance, supported by Victor's Second Corps, broke the Allied left flank and took 13,000 prisoners.
Fuck. So much fucking battle, look at... It's like you can't even see, there's so much dust around, so many shots of bullets, I don't know who's getting hit, you know, the most safest guy is probably under a pile of bodies, and he's probably safe there, stay there for another 2 or 3 days, these motherfuckers will be done fighting, and then you can get up and leave. That's the best you know, solution to escape this war. Holy shit. Wow.
The Allies had suffered a disastrous defeat because they'd ignored their own rule.
Oh.
Don't take on Napoleon in battle.
Oh, shit. French casualties, 10,000. Allied casualties, 38,000. Fuck. Dresden casualties estimates. My god. And don't even fucking dare fighting Napoleon. He's gonna fucking destroy you before you even think about getting back to him or shit. You know, it's not gonna work, okay? Dang.
But news soon arrived that turned the situation on its head.
Huh.
Marshal Oudinot had resumed his advance on Berlin with 66,000 men.
Oh.
But in 3 days of heavy combat around Grossbeeren, he was defeated by Bernadotte's Army of the North.
Oh, shit!
Some of the most savage fighting was between Napoleon's Saxon allies and von Bülow's Prussians, two German states that for now remained on opposing sides.
Oh, might as well be stay on, you know, two different sides and don't fight. Just stay there, wait for somebody to make a decision on what to do. Because what is this? So many, it's like a bunch of sticks. It's not even like rifles, it's like sticks and spiky swords, and everybody's like feeling the pain of getting stabbed or shot by them. Oh my god, it's a mess. Wow.
3 days later, at the Katzbach River, Blücher inflicted a crushing defeat on Marshal MacDonald.
Oh shit!
Some French troops into the river itself.
Oh my god!
MacDonald lost 30...
I told you this Blücher guy is like... Oh my god, he's like a... He's like a James Bond villain or some horrific villain. Some villain like from Game of Thrones. Like super sadistic, evil looking. That's how he looks like. So, meh.
1,000 men. 3 eagles and 100 guns.
So MacDonald was fucking destroyed by him. And Katzbach casualty estimates French casualties 24,000. Allied casualties 22,000. Man.
For Blücher's 22,000 casualties.
Oh, man.
3 days after Napoleon's victory at Dresden, as Van Damme's corps pursued the Allies, it became trapped in wooded valleys around Kulm and was overrun.
Wooded valleys?
General Van Damme himself was dragged from his horse by Cossacks.
Oh, God!
10,000 of his men were made prisoner.
Oh, my God! I swear, I hate these Cossacks. I hate them so much. I hate them so much. And, you know, I can't, man. I hate them really hard. They're always so brutal with their enemy. I get it that they have to protect their nation or you know, win in the war. And that's their strategy and the most effective troops ever or something. But still, like, these Cossacks dudes are so annoying. Like, honestly.
Napoleon sent Ney to take over from Oudinot, who engaged Bülow's Prussian corps at Dennewitz.
Okay.
The Prussians, fighting to save Berlin, held their own until Russian and Swedish reinforcements arrived to turn the battle decisively in the Allies' favour.
Wow!
Ney's retreat became a rout, with the loss of another 22,000 men.
Oh, God!
Napoleon's brilliant victory at Dresden.
Look at MacDonald running from Blücher. He's running away from him like a girl. And what? He lost so many people, and that dude is like monster chasing him. Holy shit.
Had been completely overturned.
Look at him run!
In just 10 days.
What?
Had been completely overturned. In just 10.
Napoleon's brilliant victory at Dresden had been completely overturned in just 10 days. Holy shit. This is a tough-ass fight, bro. I don't know what to say about this whole war. It's like so chaotic. Does victory even matter anymore? Because it's gonna overturn in 10 days, man.
10 days.
Jeez.
The Allied plan was working. Napoleon became increasingly frustrated as Allied armies withdrew wherever he advanced and advanced wherever he was not.
Oh shit, it's like, how do you call it? It's like rats or something. When you go this direction, they're coming from this direction to take over your place or something. And when you come back to attack them, they run away. But the person that you're chasing is going to come back and take over. You know, it's just, they're not leaving any spot for him. Okay, they just take in everything, whatever they wanted. You know, that's how it is. Jeez.
His teenage conscripts were exhausted by constant marching and famished.
Oh. The teenage conscripts. I feel bad for those kids, bro. I feel bad, so bad. Man. By exhausted by constant marching. Oh my god.
The Saxony had been stripped bare of supplies.
Oh, no supplies! That is even worse!
Thousands fell sick.
Thousands more deserted. Oh god.
Russian and Prussian light troops were now operating behind Napoleon's army, harassing his communications with France.
Oh god. It's like trying to fix a problem, trying to take over something. I don't know how to explain it. It's like trying to fix something that is not fixable. You know, that's how fucked up this is, this whole Russia invasion. Might as well forget ever thinking about invading Russia, because like, if it's like this, I think you need like fucking millions of troops to make this even work like this, because this is not gonna work, because they're not letting you dominate anywhere, you know?
Many of Napoleon's marshals advised him to pull back to the River Rhine.
Oh.
But Napoleon wasn't giving up Germany without a fight.
Oh god. Oh my god. Wow. There will inevitably be a great battle at Leipzig. Napoleon to Marshal Ney, 13 October 1813. Oh man, he's already predicting. Wow. He knows where this is going.
By October 1813, Napoleon faced a third of a million Allied troops in Germany.
Oh,
converging
shit.
On him from three directions.
900
miles away, Field Marshal Wellington was crossing the Bidassoa River into France.
Oh,
the first enemy.
Wellington is not a joke! Oh,
the army
my God.
On French soil in nearly 20 years.
Oh god.
While the Kingdom of Bavaria, a French ally since the days of Austerlitz, had secretly agreed to switch sides and would declare war on France on the 14th of October.
They need good spanking, because how can they switch sides like this? Come on, man! What? What?
Napoleon planned to defend the line of the River Elbe.
Oh, shit. Oh,
but
God.
But the arrival of General Bennigsen's reserve Russian army freed up Blücher, who suddenly marched to join forces with Bernadotte, and forced his way across the Elbe at Wartenberg.
Oh my god! This Blücher guy is like approaching death, you know? It's like, wherever he decides to go, it's like death approaching. It's like, oh my god! Calm down, man! I know that you're crazy, but still calm down.
Napoleon went north with 150,000 men, seeking the decisive battle that would change his fortunes.
Oh shit!
But once more, Blücher narrowly escaped him.
It's like a wave of water when it comes close and goes away. It's like that, you know. This guy is just, he's just approaching like death, and then he runs away so that he can protect himself. And when he gets the chance again, he gets back in. It's like, what is wrong with him? He's so evil. Dang. Whenever Napoleon shows up, he always runs away. But whenever there's no Napoleon, he comes back to fucking fight you. It's like, holy shit.
Then came news from Murat, who'd been left with 67,000 men to cover Schwarzenberg. The enemy had bypassed Dresden and was heading for Leipzig.
Oh shit, everything is coming to Leipzig, man.
If the city fell, Napoleon would be cut off from France.
Oh shit.
Once more, he was advised to fall back to the Rhine.
Yeah, I don't know. Listen once, Napoleon? Can you listen to them once? Like, come on, man. I don't think this is a good idea.
But instead, Napoleon ordered all his forces to concentrate at Leipzig.
Let's fight to death or something. Oh my god.
He would risk everything.
Oh shit.
One great battle.
Holy
to
shit.
To decide the fate of his empire.
What?
And the fate of Europe.
Dude, that's like an entire planet of war. Planet war. Holy. Why? Why? I mean, I get it. Like, you don't want to retreat and you can't stand humiliation anymore. I get it, Napoleon. But wow, man, look at this. So many people are fighting. Okay. Let me hear again.
He would risk everything
in
one great battle to decide the fate of his empire.
It's a fucking planet war up in this bitch. It's not just Leipzig, it's a planet war. It's everybody's fighting, and you can't even see where the fight is ending. It's just continuing across the fucking landscape, and it's like, what? This is brutal. Imagine the amount of bullets and bullets flying around, the amount of swords coming at you, the amount of horses that might come at you and overrun you and shit, you know? The amount of soldiers. You don't know where the enemies are. Look at this shit. How can you know where the enemies are unless you know how they... you can identify their uniforms wherever they go. If you don't know, then you're lost in there. Fuck.
And the fate of Europe. decide the fate of his empire.
Oh, shit.
And the fate of Europe.
Dang!
Thank you to all our Patreon supporters for making this series possible, and to Curiosity Stream for sponsoring this video.
Okay.
Visit our Patreon page to find out how you too can support the channel, get exclusive updates, ad-free early access, and help to choose future topics.
Future topics! Okay, go pay him on Patreon for these videos, because these videos are intense and he knows a lot. So detailed. It's almost like he read so many books on what happened in the past and knows a lot. Watched so many stuff. I don't know how he knows all of this. It's so detailed, like as if he was living in that time, you know? It's so detailed, it's ridiculous. But Napoleon 1813, we're the next year, guys. You know, the previous videos were all 1812, but this time it's 1813, the road to Leipzig. Didn't feel like a small Leipzig, you know, town or anything like that. It felt like a big planet. That is completely green and beautiful, but then people are... It's filled with people fighting by the end. It's like, holy shit, Napoleon doesn't stop, does he? He's insane, okay? But I hope he wins. I hope he won that, you know? And, like, putting the entirety of Europe at risk or something. Holy shit. So, whatever. Napoleon 1813, The Road to Leipzig. What did you think about this reaction? Did you like my reaction? Please don't be offended if I said something, or if I was like careless about something, or did something, said something. Please don't be offended. If you like this reaction, please make sure to subscribe to this channel. It's my backup channel. This is where I upload like three videos a day, but I'm uploading two videos here, so because I'm uploading two more videos on my main channel. Go check out my main channel, the link will be in the description. There's a lot of reaction videos over there. You'll be thoroughly entertained. And if you like it over there, subscribe over there. If you like this reaction, subscribe over here. Subscribe to both my channels. Show me support. There's nothing wrong with getting entertained, okay? So please make sure to subscribe to both my channels, and you know, go subscribe to Epic History TV. He's almost close to 2 million subscribers. He has like 1.99 million subscribers. That's insane. I never seen anything like that. Go subscribe to him. Maybe you're the 2 millionth subscriber. Who knows? Test it out. Subscribe, okay? Show him support. And if you find it in your heart, subscribe to both my channels as well. Show me support as well, okay? So, yeah, that's it for this reaction. And if you have any awesome videos, political videos, Napoleon videos, any kind of videos that you want me to react to, if you have any suggestions, videos that have like millions of views that can give me views, please tap down in the comment section, provide link or whatever. I'll note it down and react to it. I'll even say your name, okay? So on to the next Napoleon video, okay? Napoleon 1813, The Road to Leipzig. Thankfully, it was not fucked up like the previous one, you know, retreat from Russia. It was not like that, thankfully. At least it was retreat from Moscow, that is. Thankfully, it was not that brutal. But at the same time, it was still almost as brutal as that. And it was like, wow. And the ending, it's like the whole area of people fighting. Holy shit. It's like a planet warfare. That's what I saw in the end. Oh my God. I hope he won, though. I hope he did. But whatever. Okay. So please make sure to subscribe to both my channels. Show me support. You know, don't miss out on my content. Stay tuned for the next Napoleon video, and I'll see you guys later. Goodbye. Please don't be offended. Please don't dislike if I said something. I don't know what I'm saying sometimes. And if I piss you off, I'm sorry, okay? In advance, because I don't mean anything to hate on you or be mean on you. I'm not insulting any character if I say something. I mean good and peace. Don't engage in a war like Napoleon, okay? All right. So, yeah, that's it for this reaction. Please make sure to subscribe to both my channels, and I'll see you guys later. Goodbye.